And welcome to The Life of Purpose. I'm Bill Brunson.
And I'm Kit McClurg.
And today we're going to be talking about what it means to live an authentic life. And when we talk about living an authentic Christian life, probably the best, most concise, lesson on how to do that is found in the 5th chapter of Matthew's Gospel, where we find the Sermon on the Mount. That's where it begins, and it starts with the Beatitudes. And those are what we'll be discussing in this series.
And the Beatitudes all start with the word blessed or happy. And it's a Greek word that called makarios. And it is a word that refers to the possibility or the likelihood that if you act in a certain way, then it will lead to a good outcome in your life. So if you do this, therefore it will lead to this. And so you can have a blessed and happy life if you do what God calls you to do. Now, on our own, we would look at some of those things and say, well, I can't do that. But when we really give our lives completely to God, then we are willing to let God lead our lives in places we otherwise wouldn't let it go. And Matthew said, that's how you really come to a life that's filled with happiness and blessedness.
Right. And so it's a happiness that's not really determined by outside circumstance or events. But instead, it's a happiness where we find ourselves complete within ourselves, where we've figured out who we are in Christ. And Christ is the focus of our life. And from that, we find happiness.
Now, the Sermon on the Mount happened on a mount next to the Sea of Galilee. And so share with us a little bit about that.
Right. Just above the Sea of Galilee is where Jesus gathered his disciples to teach them. There currently is a chapel there that was built by Antonio Barluzzi, the Chapel of the Beatitudes. And it's believed that that's where Jesus gave this message to those, his followers, and to the crowd. And the interesting thing is that in Scripture, we have another moment when you have a significant mountaintop experience where Moses goes up on the mountain, Mount Sinai, and he receives the Ten Commandments. They told the Jewish people how to live and to live their best life for God. But when Moses went up, there was a cloud and there was lightning and thunder, and the people were ordered not to go near the mountain. Jesus goes on top of the mountain and sits down and calls everyone to come to him so that he can give them the gift of the good news, the gift of the gospel, to give them the gift of understanding how to live a life that is blessed, a life that's happy.
So the first of the Beatitudes is in Matthew 5:3, and it says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And if you read the Message Bible, which is a little bit more modern translation, it says, "You're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. With less of you, there is more of God." And I think that really sort of captures where it's at. When we come to a place that we say, "God, I am completely bankrupt. I have nothing to give," that's when we're open to what God might do in our lives.
Right, because in the New Testament, there are a couple of different words in the Greek New Testament used for poor. And one means, of course, you have no money. But the other is more severe. It means that you're absolutely destitute. And that's the word that Jesus uses here. He's basically saying, happy is the person who's absolutely destitute. But it's not destitution off of being poor in financial resources, but it's coming to that realization that we can't do life on our own. And there's a great story that connects to this. In Luke's gospel, Jesus talks about two people that go up to the temple to pray. One of them is a Pharisee, somebody who is the enforcer of the law. And the other is a tax collector, somebody who has really turned his back on his own people in many ways. And the Pharisee stands there where everyone can see him, and he begins to pray and thank God that he is not like other people, like thieves and horrible people, and not even like that tax collector over there. But the tax collector stands over in the darkness, in the shadows, and beats his chest and prays, "God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And Jesus said it was the one who was poor in spirit, the one who realized that he was absolutely destitute, who went home that day justified because God heard that sincere prayer.
Now, most often we don't have the courage to do what that man did. Mm-hmm. We instead pretend that we have life together, and we want people to see sort of a mask across our face to look like all is well. And so, but we really hide ourselves from what God's possibilities are. My mother told the story on herself of when she was a teenager and had a car. And it was back when air conditioning was first coming out in vehicles. And so it was really a kind of a status symbol to have an air conditioner. And she would drive around with her windows up in the middle of the summer with no air conditioning, pretending that she had air conditioning. Now, she could have easily had cool air or cooler air if she could have just admit that she needed that. Mm-hmm. But instead, she wanted to pretend something else about life, an inauthentic thing about herself. And so she drove around, but basically suffocating because of it.
Yeah, as long as we think that we can somehow make it on our own, or by our own merit, by our own abilities, we can make everything work out. Well, then we're a little bit too rich, like the Pharisee, who thought way too much of himself. Maybe too rich to even gain the kingdom. But God's kingdom is for us, all of us, when we realize and recognize and admit that we're absolutely destitute without Him, and that we're willing to admit that we need the help.
When we're at the end of our rope, that's where God has the space.
Right.
Now, the second of the Beatitudes is found in Matthew 4, and it says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." And in the Message Bible, who, once again, it captures it well, "You're blessed when you feel you've lost what is most dear to you. Only then can you be embraced by the one most dear to you." Now, it's kind of oxymoronic to say blessed or happy are those who mourn.
That's right. It's like when someone says that there was deafening silence, or someone was pretty ugly.
Or a jumbo shrimp.
A jumbo shrimp. Yes, oxymorons. I mean, the idea of being a happy mourner, happy because you're mourning, that's very odd to hear. But the reality is, the other side of it is you get comfort. You get comfort that is not just what we think of, which is someone pats you on the arm and says, there, you know, you'll be okay. The comfort that Jesus speaks of is someone who will come alongside you. And it's also the comfort that it says that not only will they come alongside you, but that they will strengthen you. And so it is somebody that's going to come in and actually help you be stronger when you admit that you are mourning.
Yeah, that word paraclete is the word that's used in John for the Holy Spirit, of the comforter, the counselor, the one who comes beside you and gives you guidance. Now, John Wesley really saw this mourning as related to our sinfulness, and really recognizing how, well, morally bankrupt we are, and how that only when we mourn that moral bankruptcy can we ever really experience the forgiveness and the grace of God.
Right, that those who recognize that they're poor in spirit, then they demonstrate their understanding, this holy humility that allows them to be sorry for the sins that they've committed, for their failures to live up to, you know, God's purpose in their life, and they can actually be comforted and be strengthened to live their life better. And so for Wesley knew that when we're willing to admit our sin and to mourn our sin, then we could gain a new sensitivity to grow in our faith, because we could be strengthened by the presence of God in our life to make us stronger to resist the temptation to sin again.
And you see that in Psalm 51 with David, who recognizes that he has hurt so many people in his choices in trying to take Bathsheba as his wife. And Psalm 51 is this admitting, I have really messed up and I am so sorry for what I've done to others. But that opened David up to God's forgiveness and led to a greater life for him. But there's also the other kind of mourning that we have. Sometimes when we have a loss, it's tempting to pretend that we're okay, we've got it together, you know, everything's good. And that might be a death or a divorce or moving or the loss of a child or, you know, going off to a child going to college and being an empty nester, health issues, financial, there's all kinds of things that if we pretend that everything's good, it shuts out all the people and all the resources that God has for us, for other people who've gone through the same things, who could very easily help us find happiness again.
Right. Yeah, we there's so many people out there that if we open ourselves up to it, we have so many people in our lives or that God could place in our lives who would come alongside us and strengthen us. But it's our being willing to open ourselves to that. And so in these first two Beatitudes, these first two moments of being taught how to live an authentic life, really both of these are talking about how we need to open ourselves up. To open ourselves up really primarily to God so that God can speak to us and God can help us. God can come alongside us. God can comfort us. I mean, it's an amazing thing that can happen in our life, enabling us to live an authentic life if we open ourselves up and admit that we need God.
Absolutely.